very lovingly encouraging environment you have there, and the list is so long. And I think I should specially mention about Geeta Hundal being a chairperson there, for providing such opportunity, and all the faculty members. So it is really good that students are like taking this using this platform of this faculty, and then giving us opportunity to showcase some research work. So today I am going to talk about synthetic chemistry towards the development of modern vaccine adjuvants. And you all know that now the time has changed, and giving lectures, visiting university departments, talking to faculty, talking to students, it's a different situation where we can definitely make bonds with students and interact with faculty, make collaborations. But now the things has changed, and we need to adapt to this new situation where we need to interact through this online platforms. So this is an interesting platform for me, Venus, and all your team. Thank you. So before like so my so I'm going to talk about vaccine adjuvants, and I wanted to specially talk about COVID-19, because context is such that we are all locked down. COVID-19, a pandemic by WHO, is the current global health crisis. And in last 2 months now, everybody is so much aware about COVID-19. So I'm not going to go in more details, but just wanted to highlight that as of yesterday, May 24, 2020, there are more than 53 lakhs confirmed cases of COVID-19, and many are recovered, but then still the number of deaths is huge. You can see that according to WHO, within 4 months, this infection has spread to almost all the countries and region. Recently, from a Universal Scientific Education and Research Network, we published an article mentioning about that the compliance of citizens with policies such as social distancing, sanitation, and isolation has played a crucial role in controlling this pandemic. And you can see that I have just listed few of the countries with the confirmed cases, and the China is not at all in the list, and from where this virus has started spread. You can see that the number of confirmed cases right now in China is 82,000. So definitely a strict compliance of citizens with policies such as social distancing, sanitation, and isolation has really played a big role. Several national and international cooperation have also helped tremendously for curbing the spread of this virus. And we specifically highlighted in our article for a need of a global collaboration to facilitate a research for diagnostics, drugs, and vaccines. And therefore, I feel that being a chemist, we all should be proud that we chemists are very much involved in all of these research areas. Diagnostics, I think, from GNDU itself, there are several groups who are working very closely in diagnostic area. Drugs, I think every much might be aware. We as a chemist are not much aware about how we can contribute in vaccines. And today, as my talk will be more of highlighting students about what as a chemist we can will be our role in development of vaccines. So if you look at the therapeutic agents, which I think organic chemists definitely can appreciate, because you can see that drug repurposing is something has recently played a big role, and drugs which are used for treatment of rheumatoid arthritis is being repurposed for COVID-19. The other drugs like lopinavir, ritonavir, darunavir, these are also the basically drugs which are developed for HIV protease inhibitor are being repurposed for COVID-19. Similarly, the drugs which interfere the RNA synthesis and specifically bind to rDRP, which is RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, or other enzymes which are involved in RNA synthesis, like remdesivir, galidesivir, ribavirin, these are also repurposed. Even favipiravir is also a drug which binds to rDRP. There are some other drugs like Orbidol, And chloroquine, I think everyone has heard about chloroquine as well as hydrochloroquine so much. And then nitazoxanid. So you can see that simple looking molecules. There are they look simple. Definitely there are the complexities. And as a chemist, I think we directly or indirectly definitely play a big role in enriching the literature so to make this synthesis easier. When it comes to vaccines, there are various types of vaccines. And the different types are whole inactivated vaccines, live attenuated vaccine, or even synthetic peptides can be used as a vaccine antigen. Then subunit recombinant vaccines can be developed and by taking some of the parts of these proteins. Then recombinant viral vectors, recombinant bacterial vectors, as well as DNA vaccines are the new generation vaccines. And if you can see that there are various different advantages and disadvantages of these vaccines. Especially you can see that the live attenuated vaccines, they are less pathogenic strain of microbe. Inactivated vaccines are the pathogens where the pathogens are killed through chemical treatment or heat. Subunit vaccines are the vaccines which are quite safe, and these are highly purified antigens. Toxoids are also the another kind of vaccines which specifically take care of the induce an immune response to pathogens derived toxins. Conjugate vaccines are where a lot of role of chemists or biochemists come into role, where a strong antigen, which is often a protein, is conjugated with another weak antigen, or it can be a carrier protein. So, and then there are recombinant DNA or RNA vaccines. You can see that the live attenuated vaccines, they induce a long lived responses, but there is a strong adverse effect in the immune compromised patients. Whereas the subunit vaccines, which are high level of safety, but multiple doses are required and they are less immunogenic. Then there are sometimes booster doses are required for such kind of vaccines. Then, as I just said, that conjugate vaccines are they are highly decorated one. So they will be highly expensive because a lot of very specific chemistry is required, and these vaccines has to be prepared on a highly high purity. So they will be highly expensive. DNA vaccines, they are limited to protein antigen production only because it involves transcription and translation to a specific protein. Whereas recombinant vaccines, they induce strong immune responses, but anti-vector immunity can lead to adverse effects. So there are definitely plus and minus points of these vaccines. It can take years. I am again repeating, because now we are all we are hearing about vaccines. And then and it can take years, but for COVID-19 vaccine has been fast tracked into humans, and within 5 months there are about right now 10 candidates are in clinical trials. This is the data from World Health Organization on May 22nd, where 10 candidate vaccines are in clinical trial, whereas 114 are in preclinical trial. You can see here that in the clinical trial, there are a variety of vaccines, inactivated foam, non-replicating viral vectors, two RNA, DNA, and subunit protein is also already in the clinical trial. In preclinical trial, there are variety, there are total 114, where in addition to the type of vaccines, there are new vaccines like live attenuated vaccines, replicating viral vector, virus-like particles. So these are also in preclinical trial. We should feel proud that India is also contributing a lot in the discovery of this vaccine. And you can see that a Serum Institute, in collaboration with University of Oxford and AstraZeneca, they are already in clinical trials. Bharat Biotech, in collaboration with Thomas Jefferson University, they are also in collaboration with NIV, as well as UW Medicine. So they are already having three vaccine candidates in the preclinical trial. Serum Institute has another candidate. They are working in collaboration with Cogenix. And there is one more candidate in the preclinical trial. As of May 11, 2020, around 30 Indian attempts at COVID-19 vaccines are being mentioned by Dr. K. Vijayaraghavan, who is a principal scientific advisor to PM Narendra Modi. So I think we all should be proud that we are also playing a big role in this vaccine development. So you all might be confused, like why I'm talking about all of these vaccines and antigens to chemists. And you can see that there is a big role of adjuvants in this vaccine. As you can see that Sinovax inactivated vaccine is adjuvanted with alum. Alum is a mineral salt, aluminum hydroxide. And then the another vaccine by Novavax is also adjuvanted with the Matrix-M. Matrix-M is a saponin, and we know that saponins are glycosides derived from plants. Then there are other, so many of these vaccines are adjuvanted. Maybe some information is not available right now at the WHO site. But then there is another vaccine, vaccine adjuvant, Advax, which is being developed by Professor Nikolai Petrovsky at Flinders University, Australia. And I'm happy that he's our collaborator. He's a SPARC visiting professor of Punjab University. Then there is another adjuvant, CPT, which is an oligodinucleotide. So these are the chemical compositions or components where chemists play a big role. So you can see that this slide talks about various vaccines, and you can see that there are many red dots as well as blue dots, and the blue ones are the adjuvanted. And the many vaccines right now which are coming, like in last 2 years, they mostly are adjuvanted. We'll talk more about what are adjuvants and why it is required, but I just wanted to showcase that there is a really a big role of adjuvants in vaccines. So what is vaccination? The overall goal of vaccination is to generate a strong immune response against the administered antigen. It should be able to protect, to provide a long-term protection against the infection. Early vaccines, which generally use killed whole organisms, are known to produce several adverse reactions. And those few of you might definitely remember a TB shot which was taken in school time, and a pain related to it, which remained for at least 2 to 3 days, or sometimes a week. And the new vaccines have more defined compositions and are mostly highly purified antigens. And that is what I was mentioning about the subunit vaccines. There is a distinct advantages in these modern vaccines that they are easy to produce, their quality control and safe, and they are safe. So because of their high purity nature, now they are less immunogenic, and that's why they need adjuvants. And adjuvants are the compound that help these poorly immunogenic antigens to induce strong and long lasting immune responses. So hundreds of natural as well as unnatural synthetic compounds are known to be adjuvantic in nature, but over about 6 to 7 decades, alum is the only mineral salt, aluminum hydroxide, which was being used as an adjuvant in vaccines. Very recently, MF59, which is oil in water emulsion, was introduced by Novartis. Then AS03 and AS04 were introduced by GSK, which has this immune potentiator, which are where they have added alpha tocopherol as well as MPLA. So these are the immune potentiators. If I just expand this timeline, you can see that apart from the few adjuvants which I mentioned, you can see that there's a poly-IC, MDP, which is uramidine dipeptide, then MPL, which is monophosphorylated lipid A, then CPG, ODONs, ODM, which is oligodinucleotides, then there is R837, R848. So these are the TLR7-8 agonists. Then there's a flagellin, which is a TLR5 agonist. So there are a lot of different kinds of immune potentiators being introduced as vaccine adjuvants. Let's go and get into more information about what are these vaccine adjuvants. Now, so far, you might have, I have explained to you that when the human body get infected by a microorganism, our innate immune system, it gets triggered. And you know that whenever we get infected, there is a response by body, and we can see fever, runny nose, So where the innate immunity is started to play its role. Innate immunity is it is rapid. It halts the infection, but it does not keep any memory. So while innate immunity is fighting against the microorganisms, it is also triggering a response to giving a signal to adaptive immunity, which is relatively slow and clears the infection slowly and also keeps the memory. And so that our body is protected from any of such infections in future. And toll-like receptors, they play a very critical role here between innate and adaptive immune system, where so these are the receptors of the innate immune system, which give information to adaptive immune system about the the availability of microorganisms, like or the infection by the microorganisms. So what are these toll-like receptors? These toll-like receptors are transmembrane proteins, which are characterized by an extracellular domain as well as an intracellular domain. There are total, few of these crystal structures are known now, and then there are total 13 toll-like receptors, out of which 10 are found to be functional in human. Toll-like receptors are located on plasma membrane, with the exception that so you can see here, so there are different toll-like receptors. The toll-like receptor 1, 2, then 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and 11, they are present on the plasma membrane, whereas toll-like receptor 3, 7, 8, and 9, they are present in the endolysosomal compartments. You can see that these toll-like receptors, they recognize very specific molecules, and these are called as PAMs. Pathogen-associated molecular patterns. Like for example, toll-like receptor 2 in combination with 1 or 6, they recognize nucleotides. Toll-like receptor 4, the heterodimer of it, recognize bacterial lipopolysaccharides. Then toll-like receptor 5 recognize bacterial flagellin. Whereas TLR 11 recognize profiling. And then bacterial or viral DNA and RNA are being recognized by TLR 3, 7, 8, and 9. So, the toll-like receptors are expressed, you can see here that they are expressed on the dendritic cells and macrophages, which are the specialized immune cells. They are activated by the specific recognition of PAMs, which I mentioned, pathogen-associated molecular patterns, and generate immediate defense by production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So this recognition of these toll-like receptors by these macromolecules from pathogens, there is a response, innate immune response by the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines. This pro-inflammatory cytokine productions leads to the maturation of these dendritic cells and then leads to a cellular as well as a humoral responses, which leads to different cytotoxic T cells as well as different antibodies. So it is very important to know that this discovery is very important because up to before this discovery, it was not clearly known that how our body is recognizing these microorganisms. And the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine was awarded to these three gentlemen, to Professor Hugh Butler, and the half of the Nobel Prize was given to Butler and Hoffman. All the discoveries concerning TLRs, whereas other half of this Nobel Prize was given to Professor Ralph Steinman for the discovery of dendritic cells and their role in adaptive immunity. So what is our approach now? So with this background, so what we are trying to do is, now so far I have told you that these microbes, they have defined structures. They are made up of different macromolecules. And we have to identify a specific antigen or a conjugate vaccines, which are important proteins or enzymes from these microbes. And what we wanted to do is, we now wanted to make small molecules which can mimic these PAMs, and then we wanted to make a combination of these PAMs and these antigens and make another kind of a assembled structures which can now mimic microbes, but it will be safe. So overall, in my lab, we are trying to find out new toll-like receptor agonist or other immune potentiators. We are also trying to develop nano assemblies by encapsulation. We are also trying to do lipidation or alum adsorption of these molecules for their whole effect. We are also developing self-adjuvanting vaccines, and also we are developing novel combinations of all of these molecules in the form of such assembled structures. So what we are doing exactly in Toll-like 7-ig? So by looking at the literature, we can see that Toll-like 7-ig, they recognize very specific small molecules, and you can see that there is a specific amidine, presence of amidine amine, as well as there is specific presence of heteroatoms, and then you can see that there is a critical requirement. So if these particular things are not present, so these are the pharmacophores, and then molecules will be inactive. Our interest was in this specific molecule, which we call it as BPIQ. So this BPIQ is the most active scaffold because it has an imidazo quinoline scaffold. There are no commercial availability of all of these derivatives. Few of these derivatives are commercially available, but not all. There are very highly active molecules which are not yet commercially available, and there are problems with their chemistry. That there are many few are low yielding synthetic routes. So we decided to fix these problems. So by looking at the literature, we critically looked at the literature, and we observed that specific papers from Dr. David. From Loris, he was my supervisor for my postdoc, as well as there was another article from David Ferguson from Minnesota. So they have the three different methods where imidazoquinoline is being prepared, starting from 2,4-dihydroxyquinoline or anthralic acid. So in this particular first route, the problem is that the overall is a low yield process, and this displacement of chlorine in the last step, there are several issues. In the another route, which started from anthralic acid, but anthralic acid is banned substance and is not easily available in India. And again, there are some problems with the yields in the last step. The third method was by David Ferguson, where he has used aminomaronitrile, which he did multi-component reactions with the ethyl ortho-ester and some amines to build a tetrasulfuryl imidazole, which on then Sandmeier reaction with the isoamyl nitrite gets converted to iodo compound, and then the typical Suzuki reaction, they generated amino nitrile derivative, which in acidic condition they were then cyclized to get the desired molecule. This is an interesting approach where to make a diverse substituted compounds, but you can see that it needs highly substituted boronic acids, and they are expensive. And also there is a so because of this expensive route, so then we decided to optimize the route two. We initiated synthesis from anthralic acid, but I just mentioned that anthralic acid is a drug precursor and used to make illicit drug, and that's why it is banned. So there was a problem of its availability. So we synthesized this from thalamide using Hoffman rearrangement reaction, which is a Google's procedure. And then we took anthralic acid, reacted with methazoic acid, which was prepared in situ by using two molecules of nitromethane to generate this nitro intermediate, which on further reaction with acetic anhydride cyclized to give 3-nitrohydroxyquinoline, and then we converted hydroxy to chloro and then displaced with amine. So I'm just showing one of the synthetic route here from one of the molecules. So here we have diversified and made several different analogs, and then we have studied their activity. Finally, we synthesized our the another interesting point was insulation of this amine at this position, which was achieved by using MCPP oxidation followed by reaction with benzoyl isocyanate. Benzoyl isocyanate is also another expensive reagent, from Sigma it is available 5 gram for about 7,000. So which we have synthesized from benzamide and oxalic fluoride. This is overall process. So overall, we have synthesized this molecule, and then we first optimized the biological assays. So this was done at Flinders University, Australia, at Professor Katowski's lab. And you can see that here Resicimod is active in both KLAS 7 as well as 8 cell lines, whereas Imiquimod and BBIQ, they are active only in TLR 7, whereas no activity was found in TLR 8. So we confirm that that BBIQ is a pure TLR 7 agonist. We have then tested its adjuvantic effect by using recombinant hemagglutinin as an antigen, and we can see that alone it showed a poor IgG response. Adjuvanted with imiquimod also it showed a poor response, but when it was adjuvanted with our compound, it showed a good IgG1 as well as IgG2C response. Interestingly, we asked another interesting question, that because this molecule is immune potentiator, so we wanted to see if this molecule is injected to mice and then infection happens, whether the infection will be like delayed. And exactly same thing happened what we thought. And when this you can see that this is a group of animals with the blue line, with only infection, animals died, like all the animals died like at day 11. The other group of animals where our compound was given alone, you can see that animals died before that, because these molecules, they induce pro-inflammatory cytokines, and so that's why, and all the animals died. But then when chloroquine was given, the suboptimal dose was given, you can see up to 15 days mice survived. And then because we gave a suboptimal dose, so it was a lower dose than what is required, and then after 15 days mice started dying. Interestingly, when we combined TLR agonist and chloroquine together, we can see that mice survived up to day 23. So we see that there is a specifically a good effect. So we tried to investigate, and we saw that in brain, like there was a like CD3, CD4, and CD8, like T cell response was gone down, and also the regulatory T cells were gone down. Whereas in blood and in the spleen, we can see that the T cell response was gone up, and we could see that a very specific cytokines and cytokine responses in serum, and because of which we think that mice like survived for 1 month. In addition to this, we have very recently also investigated these compounds in like TLR agonist in Leishmania, and we observed that they induce pro-oxidant and pro-inflammatory condition in these mice, and they try to fight leishmaniasis. So we have also investigated our compounds as malaria vaccines, where we have used blood stage fraction 10,000 g combined with the TLR7 agonist, and when it was injected to animals in a typical 35-day vaccination protocol, we have seen that like all the mice, you can see here the one is shown in red, group 3, all the mice survived the infection where this combination was given. So this paper is already communicated. So we have seen that our hypothesis is working, and we could develop a good malaria vaccine. And again, we have looked at the various T cell response as well as cytokine response, and we observed that these responses are helping to develop these anti-malarial responses. So we thought, okay, can we prepare a sustained release formulation of TLR7 agonist, because you can see that our target TLR7/8 here inside at the endolysosomal compartments, whereas the molecules has to cross this barrier. So in recent past, during my PhD, we developed molecules like especially bile acid oligomers, which are found to be antimicrobial because of their antibiotic nature, like these antimicrobials, like daptomycin, polymyxin, amphotericin B, and cirrogenins. They are active because of their amphiphatic nature. And that's why we thought, if we can make some dimers from this bile acid like this, they can self-assemble and can puncture holes in the membranes, which is how to see how we can achieve this selective. And fortunately, we got some molecules which were only toxic to fungal cells and not to the normal cells. So we have extended recently this SAR, and we have synthesized many more steroidal oligomers, dimer, trimer, as well as tetramers and pentamers. And we found that our lead dimers, A specifically, you can see that when combined with other antibiotics like cefotaxime, you can see that there is a 33-fold increase in its activity. Amikacin, which is a highly polar, you can see several hydroxyl groups, and you can see that there is a hydrophilic pocket in these molecules. You can see they might be fitting into here, and they can be easily delivered inside the microbes. And you can see that there is a 67-fold increase. For ciprofloxacin, again, is a hydrophobic molecule, because this molecule can now make a hydrophobic cavity also. You can see that there is a 17-fold increase in cells activity. But vancomycin, which is a very big in size, and we don't see much improvement in its activity. So definitely, there is a specific role of these dimeric conformations in its biological activity. And now we are trying to develop a combination of these oligomers with our TLR agonists, so that they can be used in combinations. So another question we asked, can we use TLR2 agonistic PAM2 CSK4 for the formulation? So why? Because you can see that PAM2 CSK4 already has a hydrophobic part, which is hydrophobic tail, palmitoyl groups, and it has a tetralysin component. So this is a typical head to tail surfactant, and they are known to assemble and form micelles. You can see that TLR2 is outside, whereas TLR7-8 are inside. So we wanted to see whether TLR2 agonist can be used in combination with TLR7-8 agonist to deliver molecules inside. So this PAM2 CSK4, this is a commercially available molecule, but around 1 milligram was available for about 30,000 Indian rupees. So definitely there was no enough material to try our hypothesis. So we decided to do its synthesis. Even though it is commercially available molecule, its synthesis was not known. So we plan its synthesis here. Ashwin synthesized PAM2 CS component in about 10 steps. Poonam synthesized its tetrapeptide component by again another 10 steps. And then they combined this to make PAM2 CSK4. Which were synthesized from very cheaply available synthones, isopropylene glycerol as well as serine. So we assumed this synthesis starting from L-cysteine. Because of lack of time, I think I will not talk about the chemistry in more detail, because these are the simple steps. You can see that cysteine was protected and then coupled with serine, and there is a SS cleavage by using tributyl phosphine. And then very typical synthetic process to get to PAM2 CSK4. So in past, I have worked extensively where we have developed molecules from complex MARP2 to a simplified PAM2 CS to PAM CS and NST PAM CS. So very recently, Ashpreet has done an extensive SAR on this molecule, and then she has made specific modification at the CD center, and also made several analogs of this N-acid or alkyl, as well as the alkylation at this place. And we have got some interesting molecules. This work we have created. So this was a total work what we are doing at present, targeting onto development of vaccine adjuvants. Apart from this, we are also trying to develop a new IDO inhibitors, because Dr. Venus especially mentioned that I should highlight all the different kind of work what we are doing, which helps students to understand what exactly we are doing. So quickly, in next five to seven minutes, I will try to highlight what all other things we are doing in the lab. So it is not exactly totally out of the track projects, but you can see in one of the slides I mentioned that because of the specific recognition of PAMs onto the dendritic cells, there is a maturation of dendritic cells, and there is a cellular as well as humoral response. There is a Th1-Th2 response. But apart from that, you can see that there is also a Treg, it also promotes regulatory T cells. And since regulatory T cells are known to suppress T helper cells responses, it may be beneficial to selectively suppress. So we wanted to see if we can develop a combination of inhibitors of Tregs and the activators of TLRs that might help specifically in cancer vaccine, because as IDO and Tregs form a mutual reinforcing system, so we thought maybe we should inhibit IDO. That's why we were working on IDO. So IDO is an enzyme which play a key role in the tryptophan metabolism, where tryptophan is being metabolized to other small molecules, and IDO1 play a critical role in the first step, which leads to downregulation of TH1 and TH17 responses, as well as upregulation of Tregs. And this tryptophan depletion environment creates immune tolerance, and that is what we wanted to see, if we can inhibit this immune tolerance. So very recently, Jyoti has developed under the supervision of Professor Mehta, who is a strong collaborator in my lab, and we have recently developed a combination of TLR agonist with an IDO inhibitor. She has developed a niosome, and we now have a very good control about release of these two molecules. So that's why now we were more interested into development of a new IDO inhibitors as well as new TLR agonist. So we have looked into the literature, and we have found that a variety of different compounds are known to inhibit IDO, and we were specifically interested in the structures which I have highlighted. And so what we did, we docked many of these structures, like Dr. Anshuman Dixit from IRF Bhubaneswar helped me. So this docking was done to understand the various features of this active site pocket. Because you can see, starting from a small molecule like ethylpyruvate or a tryptophan, a very complex molecules are also active. So we wanted to understand the exact cavity. By understanding these docking pictures, we have developed a model, and now we have very clearly understand what kind of molecules can fit in there. So based on that, we thought that a molecule which is synthesized in a single step, which is by using a Golgi Benjamin-Blackmann multi-component reaction, we can easily get to molecules which are very close mimics of this one of the lead structures. And we synthesized around 45 molecules in this project, and one of the molecules showed a low micromolar activity for IDO1. As looking at the another structure of IDO inhibitory activity, which is hydantoin-fused beta carbonyl derivatives, we have synthesized a library of compounds around this, and these molecules are being tested in IDO. Some of the molecules showed some activity. We are progressing. They are now progressed to their activity in animal studies. As we synthesized some beta carbonyl derivatives, and we saw that CYP51, which is also an iron-containing enzyme, and IDO is also an iron-containing enzyme, and there was some mention in the literature that some of the compounds which are having antifungal activity, they showed IDO inhibitory activity. So at that stage, about a year back, when we synthesized many of these molecules, as we thought, maybe vice versa also is possible, that molecules which we planned for IDO may show antifungal activity. So with this hypothesis, we tested some of these compounds, and we found that these compounds showed a good antifungal activity. So again, looking at the literature, as we had a big library of compounds ready, we found some literature where compounds, beta carbonyl derivatives, with instead of aliphatic group, if the aromatic groups are present, they show antimeral activity. And we tested these molecules in our university, zoology department. Professor Gaya helped us in this, and now Professor Subhi Rao is helping in this project. And we got a very interesting compounds showing less than 1 micromolar activity for anti-malaria, for malaria. Then another project, again, I will be taking maybe 2 to 3 more minutes only. Another project is where we have, because copticin is another molecule, you can see it's a polycyclic molecule. And so we have developed a method where we have done a GBB multi-component reaction followed by a Pitta-Spender reaction. And we have got two very interesting tetracyclic heterocycles. This work is also some of these molecules are under biological screening, and we will see this molecule. So as we were working very much on GBB reaction, so Manpreet, who is in her third year of BSc, started to visit our lab, and then very interestingly, she has developed this protocol she was closely working with Rahul, my PhD student. And they have now developed a protocol which will be useful for at undergraduate level, because we can do this whole process of synthesis, because the isonitriles are very nasty in smell, and then they are expensive to purchase. So our idea is to make them import, and then they have developed a process where we can synthesize heterocycles. So this is the whole process can be done like in 3 hours. So we wanted to develop this as a experiment for the undergraduate level. So another kind of heterocycles what we have synthesized is the benzimidazopinoxazoline. Again, I'm not telling more chemistry here. You can see that it's by a disconnection approach, you can easily understand that these molecules are synthesized from nitrofluorobenzene, where the fluorine is displaced by benzimidazole, and then they are cyclized. So these molecules we have tested in NCI, National Cancer Institute, NCI cell screening. This was just last week. Okay, so Venus, I have only 2 more slides. I can understand that I'm taking a little.
No, that's okay.
I just wanted to highlight what we are doing so that students might be interested to know what we are doing. So here recently we have done a literature survey. Poonam did a big literature survey on compounds which are like conjugates of steroids with amino acids. And then she came up with this very interesting, we came up with a very interesting review article in chemistry, where she has, I wanted to highlight to students that she has prepared this picture by using camera, and she wanted to showcase that these conjugates show a variety of activity and targeting many of these targets. So she also synthesized steroidal peptide conjugates, and we have found that these compounds show very good antimicrobial. So I think I am done with showcasing all our work. So overall, I have shown that variety of work, what is going on in my lab. It's not that we are working on totally different topics, but then all the work, as you can see, that it is directed towards the vaccine adjuvant development or its formulation. And I'm thankful to several of my collaborators. I'm thankful to Punjab University for providing this and our department for a very good and research environment, several collaborators, because we work on very different aspects, malaria, leishmania, vaccine development, then anti-cancer projects. So I think I'm thankful. Without them, it was simply impossible. Funding agencies, of course, without that, cannot actually work. I'm thankful to my research group. This is all efforts of the students who have actually in the trying condition, because when we started work about 5 years back, situation was not really good, and they have to really start from scratch, and they really helped build my research group. So I think I'm a big thanks to all of these for their efforts. There are many master students who worked for last 5 years, and they also immensely contributed in this. So this is Professor Petrovsky, who visited our lab on a Spark grant. And also Professor Bates, who came on a GAN course. So many this MHRD gave a very good platform where several professors from abroad came and visited my lab. They actually encouraged students to do a lot of good work. So thank you all. So that's it from my side, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thanks a lot, Deepak. That was a very interesting lecture. And I request the audience to please raise your hands if you want to ask a specific question to Dr. Deepak here. This is an option which is available in the Zoom app or Zoom software. So you can raise your hand in the chat section or in the participants list. So if you have any specific question or any general question regarding vaccines or adjuvants, or his research, please ask your question. You can also drop your question in the chat box. Yeah, so Deepak, somebody wrote in the chat section that University of Oxford Serum Institute vaccine has not progressed.
Yes, very true. It is just news of 2 days back. And initially, 3 days back, there was news that it is showing good results. And it is clear that I also heard about this news, but I think we need to wait and watch. I think because you see the vaccine development takes about 10 to 15 years, and now this has been progressed in 5 to 6 months. So maybe I think more trials are required. But I also can.
So the question that comes is that. There are vaccines for many viruses, polio has a vaccine, and but somehow vaccines for things like influenza or common cold. I mean, these vaccines, there are not effective vaccines for these things.
For example, like flu. Question is very valid. Like flu, like every year there is a, like flu shot has to be taken. I think when you are abroad, you might have experienced this. I think we are not very commonly taking this in India. So these viruses, like there are mutations, there are changes happening in them. So that's why it is difficult, like to get into good vaccine for them. Like even for HIV now, there is no good vaccine. So yes, I think there are a lot of trials going on. So we have to cross our fingers and see that something hits. But I think the older ways of vaccine will be better chance, because this mRNA, this RNA vaccines, DNA vaccines, these are like very newly developed technologies. So we really have to wait and watch.
Okay. I mean, so do you think in that way? I mean, this coronavirus, the current one, the COVID-19, so this is also very much similar to a common flu. I mean, it is slightly more potent, but it is like that. So targeting for a vaccine in such a short time, I mean, if we have not been successful in finding a good vaccine for a flu, like influenza, and then, I mean, how successful are we expecting us to be in this case? I mean, shouldn't we look for some other methodologies of tackling this kind of a disease?
I think it is one hope. See, like in my first few slides, I mentioned about drug discovery efforts also, because that even vaccine as well as drug discovery, they both are very lengthy processes.
Yeah.
And it is very difficult, like it cannot happen in overnight. So in this situation, as a scientist, I think we have to have positive hope, and we have to try, because alternative strategies are being taken care by other experts, like repurposing is one. And then even people now, you can see that a tremendous amount of literature already people are completed docking studies, and they came up with new molecules. But those new molecules will be available in the proper way, at least 5 to 6 years, if we even expedite, so in that way I don't think that it will be useful at this stage immediately.
So we have
for example for this vaccine also for COVID-19, because this is SARS-CoV-2, and even the SARS, like in 2003, there are a lot of companies and researchers have worked on SARS as well as MERS vaccine. Uh-huh. So there is a lot of help from those projects. Mm-hmm. I feel that researchers can take the lessons from those projects, and that's why I think it's helping in this current situation to get into human clinical trials within this short period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very true. So we have one guest here.
I'm Mandar. So I am friend of Deepak. He invited me actually, and we did PhD together in NCL Pune. So very nice talk, and I really like the development of your work, particularly on TLR 7-8, and also the thought process of having the TLR 2 inhibition to make the entry into the cells. I just want to know, like, what are your plans to progress those developments? Because all you have shown, most of the studies are mostly in vitro or activity based. So have you thought about any PK profiling of those compounds, or taking those for the efficacy studies?
This is again a good question, but in the sense, like, we are already working on that. So we are trying to see that our molecules are being, we wanted to see that these all projects need a lot of huge money. And as I said, like, it is mostly through collaborative efforts. So at least 4 to 5 research proposals I have already applied. Some came back, and we are again trying. So yes, we have plans. For example, pharmacokinetics. We have contacted a few researchers to help in this, and see. Because you see pharmacokinetics, for TLR agonists, I think it is not safety is definitely concerned, but pharmacokinetic study, like other drug molecule, is not definitely required. for this killer organism, because they will be given in a very small amounts only. So, but still, yeah, the question is valid. We need to do that. There's not much information available so far in the literature, and we want to do that.
So, is it the IV, because it's a vaccine development? Are you planning for a IV dosing?
No, not IV. It will never be IV.
So oral, right? Ultimately, it will be oral.
Oral or like IM, intramuscular.
Okay, so then you need to do the PK for certainly if you want to check the efficacy of the compound, because these are all in intro and activity based thing. It's unless until you prove the efficacy.
It has to be, yes, it has to be tested. But then again, alone testing will not be of any use. See what happens, like they will be given in the combination with some antigen. So again, like there will be, because we have observed in our work, when we have injected these our compounds with antigen and without antigen, there is totally different effect. Because these compounds, they have like binding affinity to antigens, like proteins. And in that way, their concentration, effective concentration, available concentration is totally different. And we observed that the toxicity is totally vanished when we combine with antigen.
Okay.
So alone testing, I'm still doubtful. Like, but definitely we will have to create a data and see. But then if they alone look toxic because they induce immune cell, so that does not, because they will induce immune cells and they might show toxicity. I think that thing should not be should block the research in this area.
Right, because it's, the work is so exciting. Actually, if you if you don't plan to progress it, it will only stay at a publication stage. And
it is not that. See, I worked at the University of Kansas, and I had started this program, I think in 2009. This Nobel Prize was given in 2011, and when I was working in this area at that time. So this is a new area. Very few labs in India are working. And many of the groups, 6-7 groups in US, they have did a lot of progress, and taken these molecules ahead as an adjuvant, in vaccines. So they definitely might have created good data, but still a lot of things are in patent literature and not yet came into in publications yet about PK studies.
Okay. Thanks. One more general question related to COVID, and because you are doing a lot of research in vaccine development as a chemist, just wanted to understand, we are hearing and reading about a lot of mutations happening in the viral genome, right? There are almost now 20 mutations reported for the COVID-19. So will that mutations play a spoil sport in development of therapeutics, including the vaccines against COVID-19?
Definitely, yes. I think Venus also asked the same question. And yes, it is going to make the development tough. So we need to find out only those antigens which are not very much affected, these mutations. So I think this biochemist, they have a big role here to identify. So identification of appropriate antigen is very important. And again, a combination of appropriate adjuvant.
Okay, one more question if I'm allowed. Why people are what do you think, targeting RDRP should be the important target, or the viral entry and targeting the ACE2 enzyme in case of COVID-19?
Right now it is, I don't know, because this is again a new area for me, but I think I as a medicinal chemist, I would like to target RDRP than ACE2, because RDRP is a viral target and ACE2 is a host target. So
right.
Definitely if you target ACE2, and it might have other complications. So
okay.
I think I would like to selectively toxic this virus. So I think I will prefer RDRP.
But then don't you think that targeting ACE2, you will actually stop the viral entry itself into the cell?
Yeah, but then ACE2 inhibition is also going to complicate, because you know that even when ACE2 is inhibited, there's another target, AT2.
Yes.
And that is overexpressed. And then AT2 overexpression is leading to a lot of complications in lungs.
Okay.
So I think the ACE definitely it can be tried, but then we have to see that inhibition should be a short time inhibition, and it should not be developing a molecule which will be very a small time will inhibit S2, because then we also have to have a combination. Because we need to have a blocking S2 as well as we will have to give another antiviral. Otherwise, how you are going to take care of the virus?
Okay.
So I think a combination of ACE2 inhibitor with some other RDRP inhibitor could be.
Okay. Sure. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. It's a really nice presentation. And again, thanks for inviting me as well.
Thanks. Thanks for being here and asking having a good conversation with Deepak. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. So, before we log off, so once again, the question which I generally ask, your work, you are in a chemistry department and your work is also related to something which is not pure chemistry in terms of pure chemistry, which people find a bit intimidating, and especially chemistry students, or they are like, it's too much of biology. So how do you want to put it across to the students in that way? How much biology is it, and how difficult is it to pick up these kind of things, this biological terminology, understanding the cell mechanism, how vaccines go and work, and then putting it in, understanding it from a chemist's perspective, how difficult it is, and how much time it takes for a student, for example, a PhD student, to get into the groove. Just a second, I have to unmute you. Just a second. Somehow you are unmuted. Yeah.
Yeah, Venus, I think this is a very important question because I have gone through this situation. So my transition for myself as a chemist, to a medicinal chemist, happened during my MSc, because I did MSc in drug chemistry. Mm-hmm. And then there was a lot of exposure. We did all organic chemistry. Everything was taught to us, including reaction mechanisms, all the reactions. But then apart from that, our syllabus was overloaded with a lot of things about biology, understanding physiology. And so I think that is required. So that has made a change, and I started liking reading biology. I especially feel that organic chemist, this getting into this is not at all difficult. It is just you need to have a positive effort. I think I should say that many of the biotechnology companies in India, most of the companies are led by an organic chemist.
Mm-hmm.
Look at Ranbaxy or like those now, but there are many, check any other like biotechnology company, they are always led by a chemist. They are basically chemists, and then they transform into a medicinal chemist. And then while doing that, they start learning biology. And definitely, it is not at all difficult. I would like to tell my own experience. I should be first of all thankful to Dr. Sunil David, who was my mentor at Institute of Kansas Lawrence, and I think he also might be remembering. And I cannot forget at all. Because initially I did antimicrobial work, anti cancer. It was easy. I could understand. But then when I turned into an immunology work. And then it was very difficult to understand, read. I was reading and I was forgetting, So it takes time. Even right now also, when I have to talk about some of the work which I have not told in more details, it is very difficult to explain why CD3, why CD4, CD8, what is their role, how it is changed, why that upregulation has shown some effect. So we need, as a chemist, I think we need to read, and I think it's very interesting. So
yeah.
What I feel that if I make molecules in the lab and if they are not at all useful, so what is the use of that? So it's not that maybe it can go into the literature and maybe somebody else can use it. But I think we can definitely, so in my lab, we don't do any biology. Everyone is purely synthetic chemist. We do only synthesis. Only thing is that my students get exposure to biological data, which we get from our collaborators. So we discuss about that data, and then students have to think about modifications. What modifications they should do in the molecule so that we can have a different data. So, and then slowly they understand how this SAR is developed, structure activity relationship. So I think it is a slow process. It takes time. And PhD time is a good time to do this because I think within 1 or 2 years it is difficult to get into this.
Okay. Thanks a lot for spending the time with us and giving us a good lecture. And I would now like to thank the Chemical Society and the students for taking this initiative. And I thank Dr. Deepak once again for sharing his precious time with us and discussing about his research. Thanks a lot, and please tune in for our upcoming sessions. We will keep you posted. Thanks. Okay, Deepak. Bye-bye. Take care. Next.
Bye.